I can hardly speak. His peace so unexplainable. I can hardly think as you call me. Deeper still as you call me. Deeper still as you call me. Deeper still into love. Love, love, you're a good, good Father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are, and I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. You're a good, good Father. It's who you are. It's who you are, it's who you are, and I'm loved by you. It's who I am, it's who I am, it's who I am. You are perfect in all of your ways.
You are perfect
in all of your ways.
He knows every detail of our life. Just worship him.
Come on, come on. Let's continue to cultivate this atmosphere where miracles are designed to break out because of the celebration of our Jesus. Come on, you can't celebrate Jesus and him not show up. You can't celebrate Jesus and think not that miracles are going to break out. He is a healer. He's a deliverer. He's a miracle worker, as the old school church used to say. We've got one more song, and I want to extend the invitation that if you need prayer, whether it's your physical body, whether it's emotional, mental, whatever it may be, spiritual, God can touch you. And the Bible gives us a kingdom principle. I'm all about kingdom principles. The Bible says, call for the elder of the church to anoint with oil and pray the prayer of faith, and the prayer of faith shall save the sick. I don't believe it's very complicated. I believe that God says it, we obey it, and then he does it. Amen? God says it, we obey it, then he does it. We're going to sing. We're going to continue to worship him. If you need the Holy Spirit, if it's been some time since you have been filled with the Holy Ghost, if you've never had the experience of being filled with the Holy Ghost with the evidence of speaking with other tongues, this is your opportunity to come. The church is going to pray, and I want you to pray in the Spirit as we go forth and pray for those that are ill. We're going to pray for Rita. She's been battling cancer, and we're going to believe God for healing. Amen? We're going to believe God not only for healing of her body, but healing of her emotions and her feelings. The devil is a liar. Amen? We have got the word from the King. Come on, let's sing. Let's pray.
Is greater. The name of Jesus is stronger. name of Jesus is greater. The name of Jesus has power. The name of Jesus is high above all things. There's just something about the name of Jesus. There's just something about the name of Jesus. The name of Jesus brings healing. The name of Jesus brings freedom. The name of Jesus is higher of all things. The name of Jesus is victory. The name of Jesus has saved me. The name of Jesus is higher.
Come on, if you believe in the power of that name, sing it with all your heart.
There's just something about,
something about
the name of Jesus.
Oh, when I cry out from my heart,
there's just something about,
oh, when I need healing in my body,
the name,
oh, the name of Jesus.
Of Jesus.
Savior,
Savior, risen
Breakthrough right where you're at. You can receive your healing right where you're at. You can receive your deliverance right where you're at. Come on, just give it to Jesus. Come on, there's power in that name.
Jesus. No other name, no other name like Jesus. Jesus.
Hallelujah. Come on, give him an apostolic praise, not an apathetic praise. Give him an apostolic praise, not an acclimated praise. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. When you're born again, praise always goes back to the celebration of your salvation when you're born again. When you're not born again, your praise is in direction of your salvation. Either way, it points to salvation. And I want you to know that every demon in hell never becomes desensitized or acclimatized to the name of Jesus. There's times that we can hear that name and not even be moved or not even feel the anointing or so forth, but It's not even based on your feelings. It's based on your revelation of that name, that God can move and do something because of your covenant. Amen? And this is why we see miracles take place here all the time. This is why someone was filled with the Holy Ghost up here. Someone was healed. Amen? Amen. Praise God. You're only as far away from your miracle as you can believe that you can receive it. Praise God. Greet someone around you quickly. Can you do that? Can you smile at somebody? Say, we're glad for you to be in church. Come on, greet them, greet them, greet them, greet them. Don't greet the same person you always greet. Greet, smile at somebody else that you ain't greeted. You're going to take a moment. We family around here. We friendly around here. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Yes, 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 yes. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Thank you, Jesus. All right, we welcome you today. We welcome everyone that is viewing and streaming our service that's connected with us. We believe God's going to touch you in the special way as well. And we're getting ready to turn our attention to giving. Giving. The act of tangible worship. Everyone say giving.
Giving.
The act of tangible worship.
Yes.
It is the only act of tangible worship that you have. And so we are going to sow tonight, this afternoon. And this week the Lord really had impressed upon my mind Psalms 37, verse 3 and 4. And I'll just read 3. You can read 4 for homework. But it says, trust in the Lord and do good, and so thou shalt dwell in the land. Trust in the Lord and do good. I want you to understand that anytime the Bible refers to the term trust, it's always referring to an act of faith. And it's always underscoring the authority of the kingdom. And so when the scripture says, trust in the Lord and do good, it's referencing the kingdom of God. Because the kingdom of God works based on the principles. And those principles are designed to be a blessing to the church. And so the tithe and our connection with God through our obedience, we're trusting in the Lord. And what does it say? We're going to dwell in the land. Someone say dwell.
Dwell.
What land is that? That's new spiritual territory that will always reflect or manifest in natural territory. I'm grateful because we are in the process of just expanding physically. But what we're seeing physically is because what God is doing spiritually. Amen?
Amen.
But I want you to hold that up to the Lord right now and get ready to just pray with me. Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you for the wonderful privilege, Lord, of sowing the tithe to you today, God. It belongs to you, God. We return it to you, Lord. It's an act of our faithfulness and believing, Lord, that you are in control of our finances. We know, God, that your word will come to pass. We trust in it, we obey it, and we shall dwell in the land. In Jesus' name we pray. Someone say, I'm blessed.
I'm blessed.
So you thought I was going to say amen. The word's already blessed. Amen. Praise God. And while they're collecting that quickly here, a few announcements. I want us to look forward to our light event August 20th. That's going to be from 11 to 3 p.m. And what we're going to do at the end of July, 1st of August, we've got door hangers, and we're going to be canvassing the neighborhood. Let me grab one of these. We're going to be canvassing the neighborhood and putting these within the community, amen? And because we want to show with substance, not shallowness, that we are the people of God. And so this is going to be a reflection of who we are in our community, that we're not here just to have good church. Hello. We're not here just to hoop and holler and say, look at our building and look what we've got and all of this. We're here for more than that. We're here to change this community with the power of the gospel. We're here to meet people where they're at. We're going to have a big barbecue out there, feed everybody, minister to everybody. Tables, booths should be out there. Everybody be working at. And it's going to be a great time, but we need everyone's participation and support to be a part of this. Well, I don't know if I can do it. You can do it. We need your help. Amen. Sign up in the volunteers. We need people working in the kingdom, not watching in the kingdom. He didn't bring you into the kingdom to watch. He brought you in the kingdom to work. Amen. All right, so that's all I'm going to say about that, but I want us to be mindful of that. August 27th, Passion to Paradise, third annual ladies fashion show. We need to celebrate modesty, amen? We need to celebrate. Many people are a victim simply of the culture. They're a victim of circumstances. My people perish for a lack of knowledge. Don't get so mad at people that when you see the way they dress all crazy because they're only dressing what the culture taught them. And we need to be retrained. We need to understand modesty. And so this will underscore that for you. It'll be a blessing. Praise the Lord. Also, our Israel trip that is planned for the 1st of July, sometime in the first week of July, is we'll be talking about that after church. We're going to have a meeting after church. And I think what we'll do, we'll go into the first Sunday school room or the discipleship room there. We'll go in that room there, and we're going to have Brother Norman talk to us in regards to some particularities of all this. He actually has applications, but we need to make sure that we are committed to this, if we're going to do this, and I believe that we are. Amen? We're going to Israel or what? Amen. I'm excited to preach on the shores of Galilee and to go through all the process and everything that's we're going to experience there. It's actually going to be a tangible reality. Can you imagine talking to someone? I was thinking to myself, talking to someone telling me the Bible isn't real. Now, I can theologically and through history defend the Word of God, as I always done. But someone telling me that, actually being on the streets of Jesus walk, going to the tomb, going to the upper room, seeing all the geography, it's just like, boy, you're the biggest fool I've ever met. In reality, the fool has said in his heart, there is no God. That is the most foolish statement. Amen? But experiencing that, it's going to take your faith to another level. Brother Norman will talk a little bit about that. Praise God. Hallelujah. How many are ready for some revival? All around revival. Praise God. I needed to make one more announcement. That announcement is referencing the fundraiser, popcorn fundraiser. Please turn in your orders to Sister Celia today or tomorrow at the latest at the daycare, which will be open from 6 to 6. Please turn that in today. You can see Sister Celia, go to the welcome center there. In the event you cannot find her, but go there, please, and let's take care of that. Praise God. So grateful that Brother Norman has been with us this week. Amen? We've been having just a great time in the Lord. I don't know where half of you were at, though, when we were having this conference. Amen. And if you were working, that's cool. But if you weren't, shame on you. We can't have revival unless the church is unified and working and being faithful to what we're supposed to be faithful in. Amen? We have to get out of our world, and we need to get into kingdom world. Praise God. I've got all these problems, Pastor. I've got all this stuff going on. That's your world. You need to get into the kingdom world. And believe that when the kingdom suffers the violent will take it by force. All right, I'll leave it alone. We're going to go before the Lord in prayer. And I really had this pressing thought. I was driving over here, and
You know, there's a lot of crazy stuff that's been happening in the past few weeks here. All of this murder, all these different situations, breakouts that are taking place, all of this protest, all of this strife and hate that's going everywhere. It's just a reflection of the kingdom of darkness. And, you know, they asked Jesus in Matthew 24, tell us, when's the sign of your coming? When is it the sign of the, and tell us the sign of the end of the world? And Jesus said, first thing he said, make sure no one deceives you. Verse 4. You know what he said in verse 7? For nation shall rise against nation. Now, verse 4, he says, don't let anybody what? And then verse 7, he says, nation shall rise against nation. The word nation is ethnos in the Greek. It deals with ethnicity, culture. Listen, God's church is not a black church. God's church is not a white church. God's church is not a Puerto Rican church. God's church is a Jesus church. It's a blood-bought and spirit-filled church. And we better be careful because we need to be the church to this hour, to this world. Amen. The world is going to be captured by the spirit of darkness. The world is going to perpetuate its order, and people are driven by that, but the church should be in control of the Holy Spirit, walking in the Spirit, losing the Spirit, taking authority of things, and bringing aid. Praise the Lord. But we need to pray. We need to pray for all of what's going on. We need to pray for our law enforcement officers. Amen? The Bible says in Romans 13 that they take a role of ministry. That's what it says. God has instituted government. God has instituted law enforcement. Are they perfect? No. But there's a lot of great law enforcement officers that have given their lives to uphold order and justice. Amen? You can't discount everybody. And, you know, we have some police officers here. We got to pray. Brother Joe is out there. His life is being threatened by people because of what other people are doing. He's a spirit-filled, blood-bought, saint of God that we got to cover him, pray for him, as well as the rest of the law enforcement officers. We got to stop the devil. We can't enable him. Praise the Lord. Let's all stand together. Let's pray. Continue to be in prayer, please, for our prophet, Prophet Mitchell. He had surgery, and he's in a process of recovering from that. It's a very, very serious situation. It's going to take a miracle. And that's what his ministry's been all about, miracles. Please hold them in your prayers. Please think about him even when you leave here. Think about it. Just call his name. At night, think about him. He's in my heart 24 hours a day. That man has got more love than anyone I've ever met in my life. And you know that. All the souls that he reaches for, all the people that he loves. We need to pray for our prophet. Prayer makes the difference. Prayer changes things. Let's pray as well for those that have been absent in church as a result of illness and so forth. We just need to pray God's divine intervention. How many, if you had the choice, would take everybody with you to heaven that you could? Amen? Or would you say, you can go, but you can't go? Because I really, really want to be what God wants me to be. And he's not willing that any should perish. Amen? So let's pray for that. Let's pray for our church. Hear what God is doing, all of our efforts. Let's pray for that funeral that's taking place in Texas. And let's believe God. Let's pray. Father, in the name of the Lord Jesus, we bring every one of these petitions before you right now. We do so in faith. And as the set man of this house, I loose that authority and anointing to begin to move, Lord, towards every one of these prayer petitions. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ of Nazareth, Lord. Salvation here, Lord. Deliverance here, Lord. Healing here, Lord. We believe you, God, in the name of Jesus, that you are the same yesterday, today, and forevermore. Loose your power, God. Loose your mercy, Father. Touch our prophet, we pray. Heal him in the name of Jesus. Let him make a full recovery, God. Let him make a full recovery, Lord. He has been, Lord, your messenger. He has been faithful to the kingdom. He has sacrificed. Don't take him from us, Lord. Leave him with us, Lord. He is more advantageous here than there. We pray in the name of Jesus. We pray for revival in his house. We pray for our nation, God, that strongholds would be broken. We pray, Lord God, for our president, our senators, our congressmen, God, that you would bring down corruption and raise up righteousness. Father, we pray for our entire country with all of this strife and all of this violence, Lord. Only you can heal the land. Let them turn to you. Let someone call upon your name. Let them see the power of the cross. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, we pray in Jesus' name, in Jesus' name, in Jesus' name we pray. Someone say praise the Lord and amen. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Praise God. We're so grateful for everyone that's here. I'm excited. I got to meet a new friend here, Brother Angel brought. He's going to be baptized today in Jesus' name. Amen. He's going down. And we had a great time. I'm so glad. Brother Kurt, man, you look sharp in a suit, man. You belong in a suit, man. He looks good in a suit. I'm so glad Brother Kurt was with us this whole conference week. It's been a great time. And he's going down in Jesus' name today. Amen. I'm excited about that. And if you're here today, if you've never gone down in Jesus' name, you say you believe on him, you say he's your Savior, you say that it's that you recognize that he has the power, you need to go down in the name of Jesus and just take care of the old man and let the new man rise up. Praise God. I'm going to dismiss Sunday school. Thank you, Brother Jay. I'm so glad my great friend, Pastor Breeze, is here. Some of the family from Crestwood. Amen. Pastor and Sister Breeze are just gems in the kingdom. They really are. You know, it's so easy to take things for granted because, you know, when you have something near you and you don't have to search to find it, you can easily take it for granted. People take their families for granted all the time when they have a great family. People take just the good things that they have. They just take it all for granted. And I've never, ever have taken your friendship for granted. I want you to know that. You have always, always treated me with dignity, respect, consideration, and your humility teaches me. Every time I see you, I say, God, I want to be like that. Praise God. But don't let him, that doesn't trick you, though. He is a very anointed and powerful. When that anointing hits him, it's just kind of like, psh, totally chips, amen? Kind of like takes his hat, takes it out and flips it backwards, and he's ready to go. Praise God. It's been a great delight to have, once again, international evangelists. International evangelists. Brian Norman, amen, that has taken his time and has really just, we were supposed to go, what, 4 hours yesterday? 4 hours yesterday. I think we went 6 or 7 hours yesterday. And everybody was glued to their chairs, and there's not a person that moved, and we just loved it, and we love him. We thank God for what he's doing and how God is using him around the world, his anointing, and that's what you need to understand. It's not the person, it's that anointing and office. And, you know, God is pouring out his spirit in great measures everywhere that he is going. He has the record of the most people getting the Holy Ghost in Puerto Rico, Mom. Puerto Rico, Madagascar. 15? About 15 other countries. See, but he didn't tell me that. He wasn't like a braggadocious thing that he was kind of like pulling out his tape measure, amen? He would have pulled, I'd have got him in a headlock and showed him something, but he's a very humbled man. He really is. God is using him, and we're just grateful that he is here today. And I want us to be receptive to the word of the Lord today. I want to understand that. I want us to understand that when the word goes forth, it must be personally applied to our lives. And when it is, anything can happen. Everyone say, God bless Brother Norman. Amen.
Somebody say, praise the Lord. What a great day to be in the house of the Lord. And I'm excited about what the Lord has, is, and is going to do. Now, I want you to imagine with me for just a moment before I get into the sermon. I want you to imagine with me being on a boat on the Sea of Galilee, looking around at 80% of the miracles of Jesus Christ were done around the Sea of Galilee, looking at the cities where the demonic were delivered, where legion was loosed, where the lame walked, where the blinded eyes saw. And there we're singing songs, and Pastor Otano begins to preach the word of God to us. I want you to imagine that. I want you to imagine, because I've been to Israel so many times, very safe to say more than anyone you've met so far. I've been there, I've preached there, I've led tours of pastors there, as well as individuals. I've spent days by myself. And every time I go, it opens something up to me, Pastor Otano. I want you to imagine being at the place where Christ was crucified, going to the tomb that he came out of, and with it being within your eye view, setting, taking communion, and then watching your pastor open the Word of God and begin to teach. I'm telling you, it's a life-changing thing. Can you say amen? So I want to encourage you, your pastor wanted me to mention to you, then we're going to dive into the sermon today, that afterwards, it's going to be where, Pastor? It's going to be right there. Afterwards, if you have an interest in going, you know, there'll be a little time after service where, you know, we're shaking hands, and I call it shaking hands, kissing babies, amen, and just loving on people. But make your way there, and we will share with you some of the information we have. And I just want to say this outside of the trip, but it's included in the trip. God connects people. Amen. God connects people. And I really appreciate your pastor. The more I'm around him, the more I'm impressed by him, his passion, his love for God. I mentioned it yesterday. He's got his hand in every single family in this church. Amen. His imprint. He loves you. And I also said this, if you haven't heard it, you'll never appreciate a good pastor till you've had a bad one. Brother Breeze is smiling over there. Amen. You understand what I'm saying? And what I'm trying to say to you is that you should value what you have. You should value what you have. And so the Bible says, and this is right, folks. I believe this. One, I believe it because the Bible teaches it, but it's right. Amen. The Bible said to give double honor to those that labor in word or deed. It also said to give honor to whom honor is due. Amen. I want to ask you, would you give a big hand clap of appreciation to your pastor and his wife? We love them. We appreciate you. Amen. Amen. I like that. That's good. I'm convinced they love you. Amen. Pastor Breeze, we honor you as well. Pastor Otano speaks so highly of you, and it is a pleasure to become acquainted with you. Amen. Amen. Look at your neighbor. Hey, that's right. Look at your neighbor and tell them you look good in church. If you would turn with me this morning to the Gospel of John, we're going to direct your attention to the Gospel of John chapter 8, and we're going to read verse 56 through 58. John chapter 8, verse 56 through 58. Give you just a moment to get there. John chapter 8, verse 56 through 58. And the word of the Lord speak and says, Jesus talking to a crowd of Jewish individuals, he said, your father Abraham rejoiced to see my day, and he saw it and was glad. Then said the Jews unto him, thou art not yet 50 years old, and hast thou seen Abraham? Jesus said unto them, verily, verily, I say unto you, before Abraham was, I am. Before Abraham was, I am. We know this is one of the seven I am statements in the Gospel of John, where Jesus says, I am the bread of life. I am the good shepherd. I am the way, the truth, and the life. Amen. All of them have powerful connotations, very powerful connotations. Amen. Because in the Jewish mindset, amen, they go back to Moses and the burning bush and where Moses said, whom shall I say sent me? Tell him that I am has sent thee. The God of the bush that they worshipped. Not the bush, but the God that was in the bush. Not the bush, but the God that was in the bush. They worshipped him. That's why Jesus, even in one place, said, except ye believe I am, ye shall die in your sins. Amen. It's powerful, powerful truth. It's also a powerful statement, amen, when you look at it in an everlasting way. Because when Moses asked him, who shall I say has sent me? He could have said, I was a president, but that would have meant he was only a president. He could have said he was a father, but that would have meant he was only a father. He could have said he was a healer, but that would have meant he was only a healer. He could have said he was a protector, but that would have meant he was only a protector. He could have said he was a lifter of your head, but that would have meant he was only the lifter of your head. But he told him, tell him that I am that I am. Tell him, he went on to say, tell him that the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob has sent you. What he was telling him, when you need a president, I'll be a president like nobody else. When you need a leader, I'll be a leader like nobody. When you need a healer, I'll be a healer like nobody. When you need a protector, I'll be a protector. When you need a provider, somebody, you need to hear me right now. You've been looking at the wrong source, and God was letting us know it don't matter how long this thing goes on, no matter how bad it gets, I am that I am. When you need a Lord, I won't just be the Lord, I'll be the Lord of all Lords. I am that I am. So they had that powerful reminder in their Jewish community. Jesus stands before them seven times in the Gospels. He said, I am the bread of life. I am the good shepherd. I am the way, the truth, and the life. Amen. And before Abraham was, I am. I want to preach to you just for a little bit this morning on the subject of frames. 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 Before I do, let me say, if you're here today and you have never received the baptism of the Holy Spirit, you've never received the baptism of the Holy Ghost with the Bible sign of speaking in other tongues, you are going to have a great opportunity to do so today. If you're here and you need a miracle, I got good news for you. You can't scare my God. Amen. I've been in meeting after meeting in America, overseas as well, where the lame have walked, blinded eyes have opened, deaf ears have opened. Amen. Mute people have spoke. Amen. And even spoke in tongues as they receive the Holy Ghost. Amen. And so I don't do it. You don't do it. They didn't do it. But we've got a God that if you ask, he can do it. Can you say amen? And so all things are possible today. I want to preach to you for a little bit on the subject of frames. God bless you. You may be seated. Frames. Frames. A frame is a border or case for enclosing a picture. Let me say it again. A frame is a border or it's a case for enclosing a picture. All of us, each of us, every one of us as individuals, we have frames that are in our life. Amen. We see things through the lens or the frames of our existence. You've heard the saying, well, you're looking through rose-colored glasses. And it's an old expression, an old American, and probably we can trace it to the Midwest and our part of the country, and maybe the southern roots, the western, probably the whole country. Amen. But it's a phrase that tends to this thinking that you're being overly optimistic, you're being naive. But what it is referencing is that we're seeing life in a certain way. One of the most powerful stories that I've ever been exposed to, and it's quite humorous too, is the story of Sam and Joe. And Sam, I share this often, but Sam and Joe were from Canada, and Canada had a wolf population problem. You see, it's legal to tan and attract, to catch, to kill a man, sell the meat of wolves, and then tan their hides and sell them as well. In Canada, they do this with wolves, but the wolf population was still growing, and it was eating off the livestock. And so what happened is it became very profitable business. Sam and Joe were brothers. They were trackers. They killed wolves. They hunted wolves. They tracked wolves. They killed wolves. They sold their meat. They sold their hides. And they made money on whatever they could sell it for. But now, because of an excessive population of wolves, the Canadian government literally put a bounty on every wolf, because the wolves were attacking the livestock of the farms of Canada. And this was causing a food shortage in Canada, which obviously is a problem for human beings. And so they put a bounty on them. Sam and Joe went out to put out extra traps. Amen. And they were sleeping one night. They just put out a bunch of extra traps. And Sam and Joe were sleeping in their tent. And amen, their brothers, a big tent, one on one side, one on the other. The campfire's blowing and going. And you know, Sam is just there. And he's sleeping. And I guess he's probably snoring. You know how men are. And Joe is woke up. And Joe's woke up. And he wondered, what's that noise? That sounds weird. And he unzips the tent and he looks out and he hears an even larger growl, and he looks around the campfire and he counts he sees the eyes of wolves that are glowing in the campfire, and he counts what appears to be about 100 wolves that have surrounded their camp. And of course, you know, Joe's scared by this. He's surrounded by 100 wolves, and he zips the tent closed. He backs in slowly and he pushes on Sam, you gotta wake up. And finally Sam wakes up, and Sam said, Joe, why are you waking me up? And said, it's late at night, early in the morning. What are you doing? He said, Sam, we're dead. We are dead. It's over with. We don't know what we're gonna do. And, amen, they're gonna kill us. And he said, Joe, what are you talking about? He said, Sam, come with me. And he took him to the tent, and amen, he slowly zipped it out, and he said, look, you see all those wolves that are surrounded him? And Sam looked, and he said, yeah, I see him. He said, Joe, we're rich. We're rich. We're rich. We see life through frames. Can you say amen? And let's be honest, these frames are not always good. We bring our bias, and I don't mean that I mean that actually in all ways. We bring our bias to situations, and we have our predispositions to situations, and we come there, and if we're not careful, our frames will limit what the Almighty God is trying to do in our situation. If we're not careful, we'll bring a frame to a circumstance, and it will be a cycle of self-fulfilling bad prophecy. Amen. But I'm talking to you about frames that border our case, that encloses a picture, because you see, every one of you have frames in your life. It's called your eyeballs, and you see things, and you bring your predispositions to it, and you bring your negativity or your positivity, your cynicism or your pessimism, or your absolutism that God is going to do something. I open up the book of the Gospel of John, and I read God's dream chapter. It's John chapter 1, verses 1 through 2, and verse 14. This is God's dream chapter. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. The same was in the beginning with God. Verse 14, and the Word was made flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld His glory as of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. Now hear me and understand me, amen, that when we go to the original Greek, we could have literally, amen, translated the Word word that we translate as the word, we could have translated it accurately as the plan. In the beginning was the plan, and the plan was with God, and the plan was God, and the same was in the beginning with God, and the plan was made flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld his glory as of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. I want you to know that from the very beginning of time, that God's plan has been to walk with men and to talk with men and to abide with men. I want you to know that you are not the enemy of God. Sin is the enemy of God. The devil is the enemy of God. But you are not the enemy of God. You are the one that Jesus died for on Calvary. You're the one that he was buried for. You're the one he was resurrected for. You're the one that he's knocking on the door of your heart and saying, if you just let me in, I'll bring joy and healing and wholeness and happiness and restoration and regeneration and victory. I'll make you to be an overcomer and to sit with me, amen, by the rivers of life in the shores of glory. Amen. You're the one he wants relationship with. I'll never forget, our country is bad about this. I'm not the most timid of people, so I dive into it. Our country is so bad about making things, about divisions and different things. And there was a movie several years ago called The Passion of Christ. It was the world's largest ever watched movie, amen. And it was by Mel Gibson, whoever, whatever the things it is. But it did portray a powerful truth, amen, of Jesus Christ being crucified, buried, and resurrected. And so one of my preacher friends, a good buddy, you all would know him, Charlie Mahaney, amen. When it came out, he was interviewed by not a Christian radio station, but a regular radio station. They wanted to get a reverend on there. Man, they really wanted ratings. Amen. They wanted ratings. So, you know, they're just wringing their hands. We're going to pit the Christians against the Jews. Amen. We're going to get us an audience today. Amen. And so they asked him, they said, Reverend, did the Jews kill Jesus? What a question. And you know what Charlie Mahaney said? He gave them a biblically proper response. You know what he said? He said, no, I did. No, Reverend, you misunderstood us. Did the Jews kill Jesus? He said, no, I did. Because 2,000 years ago, he looked into the future. And he thought, there's going to be some little Arkansas boy. Actually, he's a Missouri boy. He said he's going to need, amen, salvation. And so he, amen, 1,000 soldiers couldn't have kept him on that cross. Amen. Nobody could have crucified. But he said, listen, I'll die in his place for his sins. Can you say amen? I want you to know, if you want to know how much God loves you, the Bible said, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have life everlasting. It says in 1 John 3:16, hereby perceive we the love of God, that he laid down his life for us. There's a reason Matthew 1:23, the Bible declares, amen, the Bible declares that his name shall be called Emmanuel, which being interpreted is God with us. Oh, Brother Norman, you don't know my fears. You don't know my predicament. You don't know my problem. Amen. What I do know is God wants to be with you. What I do know is God wants to be with you and your circumstance. Amen. He does not want to be God up there and God over there and God around here. He wants to be a God that walks in you and talks in you and abides in you. He's the prophet, amen, the apostle in 2 Corinthians 6:16 declared, amen, that the baptism of the Holy Ghost was the fulfillment of Joel's prophecy and other prophets. And he said, I will dwell in them and I will walk in them and I shall be their God and they shall be my people. Ladies and gentlemen, brothers and sisters, I want you to know today that you are God's dream. God's dream is to walk with you and talk with you and abide with you. Amen. You say, Brother Norman, you don't know where I've been and what I've done. Well, that goes two ways, by the way. You don't know where I've been or what I've done. But what I can tell you, no matter how bad you've been, no matter how, amen, how deceitful, amen, or damnable the things may have been you've done, I want you to know that Jesus will go to the end of the world for you. He'll even go to a cross, let himself be crucified, be buried in a grave and rise again, just so you can be reunited in right relationship with him. And there's not many people that'll die for you. But there's one who already he did. You are God's dream. You are God's dream. Walk with you and talk with you and abide with you. And when you think about the goodness of Jesus, amen. There's nobody like Jesus. I said there's nobody like Jesus. Jesus heals and saves and delivers even unto the uttermost. Bible said that eye hath not seen, ear hath not heard. Amen. We can't even begin to comprehend because we've only got an earnestness of our inheritance. Even those that are born into the kingdom already, guess what? We've got a degree of comprehension, but we can't fully comprehend because we've only got the earnestness of our inheritance. We've only got a down payment. Amen. There's a difference between owning the house and putting a down payment on the house. Can you say amen? What I'm trying to tell you is no matter how great and glorious and powerful you think he is, he's greater than you think he is. He's more powerful than you think he is. He's more loving than you think he is. He's more forgiving than you think he is. He's not the God of the second chance. He's the God of the third and the fourth and the fifth and the sixth and the seventh and the eighth and the ninth and the tenth. Somebody ought to shout amen. You say, preacher, but I fell down. Pick yourself back up again. For the righteous man falleth down seven times, but he gets back up again. Oh, I wish somebody would hear me today. Amen. I know what you've been up to. Lord, don't hide everything from me. But I want you to know the mercies of God are much more powerful than your mistakes. I want you to know it don't matter how far you fail, grace will reignite you with God. Mercy will forgive you. Grace will reignite you. And you're going to be a new creature. I love it when the psalmist said his mercy is renewed daily. Wow. Amen. So God's dream is you. As individuals, though, we have frames. If we're not careful, these frames will limit. Amen. They will not listen to me. You need to listen to the preacher today. Even some of you need to close your frames. Amen. And open them up and listen to the word of God. Amen. Frames. If we're not careful, they'll be a blessing. But if we're not careful, they will be a hindrance to what God is trying to do. A couple years ago, I was praying. It was not the beginning of, it was the end of 04. We're in 2016. Boy, the years fly. Amen. It was in December of 2014. And every year, at the end of the year, God gives me a prophecy for the next year. I've prophesied thousands of times. I've never missed one yet. Don't hope to ever miss one. Amen. But this is not a prophecy to anybody else but to me. Now, sometimes it's a prophetic sermon. And I'll know that I'm supposed to preach that sermon every place I go that year. So much so that if I go there for just one sermon, I automatically, Pastor Breeze, I'm going to preach that sermon unless God tells me otherwise. It's a prophetic word for that year. And I was praying and... God began to speak to me. You know what he began to speak to me about? He began to speak to me about frames. Amen. Now let me be candid with you. I'm going to brag on what the Lord's done. Amen. Not what I've done. Amen. Because if it was what I'd done, we'd all be in trouble. Can you say amen? One man may water, one man may sow, another man may water, but only God gives the increase. Amen. And so, long story short, what I'm trying to say to this, we've seen, I like to tell people that everybody's blessed, but I'm spoiled. Amen. I've got a first class front row seat to the glory of God, and I get to watch him fill people with the Holy Ghost and heal people and do miracles and change lives. I mean, it's awesome being in the kingdom of God. but I'm the guy, and I'm just being open. I'm one of the guys, or the guy they bring in to preach the big crusades for the Holy Ghost outpourings. I'm the guy when they want to have a miracle meeting, they'll call me. Probably a few months ago, I was visiting, and Jack Cunningham was introducing me to Lee Stone King. I'm just giving you an example so you don't know I'm exaggerating. Amen. And we knew each other, but not formally. So Brother Cunningham's introducing me to Brother Stone King. He said, "You're the guy that sees all the miracles in the meetings. I don't do them. You don't do them. We don't do them. But God can do them." Can you say amen? God can do them. Can you say amen? We just ask, but we know a God that answers. And so I said that here I am talking to God. And you know what God tells me? He said, "You need to destroy some frames in your life." Me? I'm high faith, God. I'm faith on steroids. Amen. I'm high faith, God. The gift of faith's even flowing through the ministry a lot of times. God, what do you mean? He said, "I'm not talking to you, I'm talking to you. You have some frames in your life that are limiting what I can do." Amen. Got quiet in here. You see, we come from our backgrounds, and understand these words and the way I mean them. We come from our backgrounds, and we come from our experiences, and we get filled with all of this sometimes junk. And if we're not careful, what we'll do is we'll bring our prejudice to a situation. We'll bring our bias to a circumstance. And somebody else, amen, somebody else sees, an acorn, and somebody else sees a forest that's about to be happening. You understand what I'm trying to say to you? Everybody listen to me today. The preacher is going somewhere, and it's going to bless your life if you'll let it. Amen. And somebody come to church today. It's just another church service. The preacher going to preach. Mama going to make me happy here, and I'm going to have to listen and say amen a few times so they still say I'm saved and amen. And that's the frames you brought to this service. But somebody else come and they said, "I'm hungry, hungry, hungry. I'm going to get my blessing. I'm going to get my joy. I'm going to get my happiness." Now both of you are sitting in the same church service, listening to the same songs, and you're hearing the same preaching and the same word of God, talking about the same Jesus, but one of you had a bias that it was going to be bad, and another one had a bias that it was going to be good. What I'm trying to tell you is some of you need to get rid of the frames that in your life, and you need to start looking at the opportunity of God. Can you say amen? Somebody ought to shout hallelujah. You need to start looking at the possibility of God. Amen. Amen. Somebody come in and said, "Well, the church has prayed for me 20 times and I've never been healed. I'm glad they love me. I'm glad they care for me. I'm glad to be a part of the church, but it ain't just, never gonna happen." Amen. Another one says, "My Lord, I've been prayed for 20 times. Amen. It's gonna be awesome when God does it on number 21. It's gonna be awesome when God does it on number 21. I'm gonna have a testimony. Amen. And I persevered until the Lord heard my prayer." You have to watch the frames you put in your life. One time when I was doing business, amen, and since when I was pastoring a church, I was running the business in my early 20s. It was God ordained. I mentioned to you, some of you the other day, I was raised in the bottom 1% of the country, so don't talk to me about poor. I'm well acquainted with poor. And then God, I got in the church, he told me to get in the business, and he used it to train me a lot. I actually got exposed to a lot of training, leadership, and stuff that is not common in church. And you know, not all of it's good, but some of it's great, to be honest with you. And so here I am, I'm managing for a major insurance company, half the state of Missouri, and a 1/4 of Arkansas. And I called into the home office, which had about 500 plus people dedicated to helping people like me, and they had 30,000 people working for them in the country. And I called and I asked this lady to do something. And listen what happened here. I asked this lady to do this, and this was really my first, I think, face-to-face exposure with frames. I think the first time it really dawned on me. Here's what happened is this lady, I asked her to do something. She said it can't be done. Well, I knew better than that. Why? Because I'd been working for the company for a few years. I also didn't know her, so I knew she was new. Amen. And she just told me it can't be done. And man, the conversation just escalated. Amen. Because the truth is, I was a manager,
And she was supposed to do these things for people like me. So I had her transfer me to somebody else finally. But I'm telling you, the conversation ended on an escalated manner. And I felt like she's trying to reach through that phone and she could grab my neck and wring me. Amen. And she was this close to cussing me. I was this close to blessing her. Amen. And you know, that conversation bothered me that day. I did my work. Well, I'll be honest with you. She was out of line. I was her superior. She was supposed to be helping me. I'm just being blunt with you. I was the manager. And I'd even voiced to her at one point. I said, listen, ma'am, you're going to do this. That's how high it escalated. Whether you like it or not, that's what you're paid to do. And you're supposed to be helping me, not vice versa here, okay? I mean, she'd agitated me. Like I said, I got close to the blessing mode. Amen. Smile a little bit. And you know what happened the next day? Later that day, I thought about it. And that morning, I was doing my daily devotion and prayer in my office. And, you know, I called and I said, God, I want to practice Christianity. Yeah. Oh, got quiet in here. Wouldn't it be good if we practiced Christianity? Yeah. Come on, somebody. And you know what? I called in to get another problem fixed, Pastor Otano. And do you want to know who I got on the phone out of 500 people I could have got? It was her. And she started in. I don't know what kind of sayings they use in Indiana, but she was like white on rice or bulldog on bone. I mean, she just started on. I mean, she just went right in, dived in. And you know what I did? This time, I didn't respond. You know why? My frames were different. Because the day before when I called her, I was a business manager, and this was a secretary whose job was to do what I asked her to do. And how dare her not do it? And let me tell you what her frames were. Well, we'll get to that in a moment. The day when I called her, I was a pastor. That day, that next day, I was a pastor who just happened to do business. Somebody smile a little bit. And so when she started in like bulldog on bone, I said, wait a second. I let her finally come down after she ran out of breath. Amen. I said, now listen, ma'am, listen to me real carefully. And I don't remember word for word, but the gist of what I told her. I said, listen, you know, a lot of people work for this company. They're not Christians. And a lot of people who have my position, they call you and they cuss you and they demand and they tell you what you're going to do and you have to do it. You don't like to be talked to that way, do you? She said, no, I don't like it. And she went on, started venting. I said, but here's the thing, ma'am. I've never done that. Oh, it got quiet. And I said, here's what I want you to do. You're new at your job, and I know what you're supposed to do, and I know you think you can't do it. You're going to talk to that lady right beside you who's worked for the company so many more years than you. She's going to tell you I'm right. See? And here's what happened. Her frames were this. She saw every manager who called as somebody that was going to cuss and do dirty and treat her like she wasn't worth nothing. Can you say amen? So she had bad friends. Well, preacher, you meddling. No, I'm going way deeper than meddling. Amen. The Holy Ghost is here. Amen. What I'm trying to say to you is we bring our frames into situations, and we got to learn to widen that frames and see the possibility of God. You may be on the workplace, and that manager cusses you. You don't know it, but someday he may be a pastor, and God may have put you right there by him to witness to him. You may think that was a problem, but really it was just an opportunity for God to do a miracle in your life. You may think that nobody likes you, but the truth is they love you and you're biting their hand off every time they reach out to you. Come on, somebody say amen. I want you to know today that you are in the greatest place you could ever be, and that is in the church of the living God. And when you come here, hey, open up your eyes and look around you. The love of God is here. The power of God is here. The possibility of God is here. And God is not against you, but God is for you. He's trying to help you. Amen. Don't bite the hand. The old saying, don't bite the hand that feeds you. He's trying to give you love and joy and victory and peace and happiness and salvation. He's reaching out and calling you and courting you, and he wants to give good things unto you. But you can't. You can't receive when your hand is closed and it's ready to hit. Can you say amen? Let's lift our hands and give God some glory and give God some praise. And come on, somebody give God, somebody tell the Lord, Lord, open up my eyes. I want to see the possibility of the moment. Amen. Oh, somebody, you need to hear me. At Christian Revival Center, this was just another building. Amen. This was just supposed to be another store. But God said, I'm going to build and do a church. And it's going to have 100, then 150, then 200, then 250. Going to have 400, 500, 700, 800. Amen. God said, hey, you see a building. Hey, Pastor O'Connor, open your eyes. I see a church. I see a church. I see a church. And Pastor O'Connor, hey, people, I see a church. I see a church. Somebody, let God give you a new frame. Let God give you new friends. We call him Abraham, the father of the faithful. Amen. But you know who he was first? He was Abram. He was a pagan. Got quiet. I'm assuming that means you're listening to what I'm saying. He was a pagan. He was a pagan. Abraham was a Gentile before he was a Jew. Study your history. I'm well versed in it. Study your Bible. Old Testament, Hebrew Bible, whatever term you want to use. He was a Gentile before he was a Jew. Became one by faith. He was raised in Ur of Chaldees of the Mesopotamia region. They were pagans. They were polytheistic. Everything was a little g, little g. Everything was a god to them. The river was a god. The sun was a god. He had a thunderstorm. That was another god. Everything was a god to them. And out of that culture, which in modern day geography would be close to where Iran's at and in that area, out of that culture, God calls him to worship him alone. You know, the one that said, I am he, and beside me there is no other. Pretty exclusive, isn't it? In fact, he made his first commandment in the Old Testament, thou shalt have no other gods before me. Little g. Stuff like that. You know, stuff like, hear, O Israel, as they would literally say in English, a literal translation, hear, O Israel, the Lord is our God, the Lord is one. Deuteronomy 6 and 4. You'll see that at the Garden Tomb, by the way. Amen. Long story short, amen. Here is Abram. He's not Abraham. He's not the father of the faithful. He's a boy that's raised to see everything that happens as another god. And then God calls. We often think God called him. God called his father and him. Because his father took them out of Ur of Chaldees of the Mesopotamia region. And his father, at the end of Genesis 11, dies in the city of Haran. And then, guess what? In Genesis 12, God calls him specifically. And he tells him how he's going to have to leave his country, his kindred, his father's inheritance. Now, folks, this is a radical call of trust. And here's the reason it is. Because in the ancient Middle East, you could not survive unless you knew your country, because water doesn't just flow everywhere in those deserts. And I've been throughout the Middle East, not just Israel. I've been in all the, not all, but a high percentile of the neighboring countries, and most of them quite a few times. Amen. And so, long story short, God says, I want you to leave the country where you know how to survive, where you know where the water supply is, where you know where the wells are. By the way, you got to leave your kindred. Now, that might not sound significant. That is powerful. Because in the ancient Middle East, the robbers would come, and if you weren't with a large caravan, they would overtake you and steal from you and leave you for dead if they didn't kill you while they were there. And so somebody traveled with their family. Oh, you mean your wife and four kids, because they had big families then. No. I meant your wife and your first cousin, second cousin, third cousin, fourth cousin, fifth cousin, their wives and their kids is how you travel. You traveled for safety. And in every single one of those groups, there was what was called a patriarchal father. Now, we don't have a lot of patriarchal society. We don't have a patriarchal society anymore in America. Some households do, but most don't know what I mean. Patriarchal society is when there is a father figure. And that father figure makes the decisions for the whole family. And so that father, he makes a decision, and they all trust him that he will make a decision that is best to provide for them and to protect them. And so here's Abraham, and he no longer has his patriarchal father. And God's asking him, now, by the way, leave the country where you know how to survive in. Oh, by the way, you're going to leave most of your family members behind that you use to protect you in case something does go wrong. And then it gets worse. And, oh, leave your father's inheritance. Now, there were no .com. Sorry, no NBA contracts given out then either. No football contracts. No get-rich-quick schemes. Capitalism wasn't in full force. Amen. You know how you got it then? It was simple. Daddy gave it to you or you didn't get it. Hello. If you were blessed, Daddy gave you 100 goats and maybe a few lambs. And then if God blessed you, the 50 lambs became 200 lambs. Amen. That's how you got it then. And God says to leave thy country, thy kindred, and thy father's inheritance. And then here is this boy that has always saw everything as a little god. That was his frames. That was his frames. And now the one true God steps into his arena of life and says, follow me. Follow me. And his frames, he had to destroy those frames. He no longer could look at every little thing that happened as another little g god like the Hindu philosophy. He now had to realize there's only one all-powerful, almighty God, and I'm going to listen to him and him alone. And now God, he asked him, it's another set of frame. Now God says, by the way, step away from the setting and the situation where you know how to survive and you think you're making the best circumstances, but instead, I want you to follow me. And he did it on the basis of a promise, a land I will show thee. Wow. Wasn't the only time frames would be destroyed in his life. Let me explain to you. You see, frames get in our life, and I've already told you I'm guilty as well as you are guilty. In fact, I'm just going to confess it to you again. We're all guilty. Well, I got one amen. Somebody say amen. Amen. We all, and by the way, it's not just one segment of our life, it's every segment of our life. We bring these frames and lenses into these situations. And we do that, and we do it in regards to God and our life and circumstances. And it wasn't a one-time event with Abraham. You know why? Here's Abraham, and he's looking down at his body. And in the ancient Middle East, understand this, you were blessed if you had children. Now, how'd you like to go around thinking you're the man of promise? You're the one who walks with the Almighty God. You talk with him, and everybody around you says you're cursed. Why? Because in the ancient Middle East, if you didn't have children, you were cursed. Why? Because if you had 20 boys and 10 girls, you could have those 20 boys, and even the girls could help. They could tend to a lot of sheep. Got quiet. You think your daddy treats you bad because he makes you make your bed, huh? Amen. Oh, I'm about to meddle right now. Amen. We got a church group in Missouri, amen. They take people that have really went the wrong way, and they put them in a church camp. They got a big church there. Hundreds of families from around come to it. They got workers, amen, and amen. And one boy sued him who was there. He sued him because the owner, he's a mass millionaire in Missouri, and he's like in his early 80s. The boy kept butting heads with everybody, so he said, listen, your job the next week is you're going to clean up the manure in the farm. Got quiet here. Amen. So he brought the lawsuit, and his parents come and got him. He said, yeah, you know, you can get him. This is a volunteer thing to be here. And they brought it before the judge, and the judge said, how you mistreated him? He said, well, I'm just doing the same thing to him my daddy did to me. I had to do it for 3 months. Amen. Smile a little bit. It's going to be all right. And so not everybody, amen, Abraham's going through this situation. He's destroyed his frames, and he's looking. Amen. He's walking forward, but yet everybody's telling him he's cursed. Amen. Because he didn't got kids. And you know what God does? God is so much wiser than us. God wanted to do something so great that he couldn't even communicate it in language that Abraham could understand. In ancient Hebrew, now I define that as from Adam up until Moses. Moses apparently introduced a greater alphabetic system, a greater arithmetic, a greater math system, let me put it that way, into the Hebrew language. He really did. Is this all right, everybody? Say amen. I know I'm digging a little deep today, but we got one service. I won't be much longer. But Abraham, Moses apparently introduced a higher mathematical system into the Hebrew language. Because for in ancient Hebrew, and this is I'm defining it from Adam up until Moses, it was impossible to express over 400 in the Hebrew language. Impossible. This is what the scholars say. My friends that have lived in Israel decades, and they're experts of experts when it comes to Hebrew. And so, long story short, here's God, and he's trying to talk to Abraham, and he can't even communicate in his language how great the thing is he wants to do. So you know what God does? He said, come here, Abraham. Come here. Come here. Hey, Abraham, come here. You know, he says, come here. Come here, Abraham. Come here, man. That's you. Come on, you get to be Abraham just for a moment. Don't get big-headed. He said, come here, Abraham. And Abraham steps outside of his tent. He said, look up. Look up. I'm going to make your descendants like the stars of the sky. And I'm going to make them like the sands of the sea. I know I can't tell it to you in a mathematical number that you understand, but if I can get it in your vision, if I can get it in your frames, if I can get you to see what I'm wanting to do, there's no limit. Oh, somebody, you ought to shout glory. Amen. Somebody, you ought to shout amen. I'm trying to tell you, God is trying to destroy some frames that are in your life so you see the possibility of God. I'm looking for somebody. Hey, come to church today. I'm in the church, amen, but my husband's coming, my children are coming, my grandpa's coming, amen, my neighbor's coming, amen, we're coming. I see it. Hey, I'm looking for somebody that opened the frames. And somebody, you come today, but you were bound, but you say, hey, I'm going to leave delivered, I'm going to leave with joy and happiness and victory in my Jesus.
You got to
have frame. Let's lift our hands and worship God right now. Come on, somebody give God glory. Somebody give God praise. Amen.
I was preaching. Here's a photo. I was preaching in Oklahoma. Here's a photo. I was preaching in Oklahoma, and I was doing a miracle meeting for Pastor Terry Irwin, a presbyter there in Paola, Oklahoma. It's about 45 minutes south of Oklahoma City. Amen. And I'm preaching for him, and we're doing a Sunday, Monday, Tuesday night healing and miracle meeting. Sunday I preached, power of God moved. And I'm wondering, where is the miracle for this meeting? Just something in my spirit. Where's the miracle? And Monday night I'm there at the door of the church. Me and Pastor are the first one there, and I'm greeting, meeting people, meeting, greeting as they come in. The first one there that's Monday evening was Brother Franklin. Brother Franklin, and you know, Brother Franklin was being pushed in a wheelchair by his wife. By his wife. Now, Brother Franklin wasn't that way Sunday. Brother Franklin's been in the church a long time. I won't guess his age, but you know, he's mid to high 70s. He's just an old country boy in Oklahoma. He's a farmer, amen, still works on the farm. And I saw him, his wife pushing him in the wheelchair. First people to the church besides me and the pastor and the staff. Pastor O'Donnell, my heart leaped up. And I felt like God spoke to me, that's your miracle for this meeting. And I asked him, I said, Brother Franklin, what happened? He said, well, I was working on the farm today, amen, and a big piece of machinery dropped on my foot and it crushed it into many pieces. And he had a cast on his foot. And the doctor told me, said, we need to immediately do surgery for you and send you to Oklahoma City and do surgery. And he said, I'm going to tell you, Mr. Franklin, you know, he'd been his doctor for years. You may never walk again because you're older. That's not going to heal right. But even if you do, you're going to drag that foot because, you know, if you were young, it's broken so many places. It might heal, but
you know, Brother Franklin, I mean, he came with the building. He's been in the church a while. Can you say amen? I did no offense, but he's just older. You understand what I'm saying. It's the truth. And so, you know, I said, well, why didn't you have surgery? He said, well, no, I told the doctor, I've known him for years, and God's healed me before. I said, listen, we're having a healing and miracle meeting at church. And so he said, you just throw a cast on that, give me some pain pills. I'm going to church tonight. Amen. Amen. And so he came to church. Now, church started. I watched him. He was sitting right about where you're at, Brother Angel. And I was sitting right about where they're at. And I watched him. He got his backside off that pew, that chair like this, about that far. And he sat back down with pain on his face. And the Lord spoke to me and said, I told you I'm going to heal him tonight. I thought, well, Jesus, do it. I'm going to watch. Amen. That's what I'm going to do. Now, I don't suggest you try this at home or at church. I don't do this. This is kind of a one-time thing, what I've done, what I'm going to tell you. And so service is going on. The power of God's moving during worship service. Amen. And you know what? I look at him, and the Lord speaks to me again. I'm going to heal him tonight. And at that point, I had a moment or two, and this was some years ago, but I felt relevant to today. I had to make a decision, so I walked down to him. I thought, okay, God, we're going to put you to the test. I said, Brother Franklin, do you believe God can heal you? He said, well, sure. He said, he's done it before. I said, Brother Franklin, do you trust me? And I stuck my hand out. And when I stuck my hand out, he took a hold of it. He said, yeah, I trust you. And I don't suggest you try this at home or at the church. I don't do it. But you know what I did do? I jerked him out of that wheelchair. And I watched that older man run around the church, jump up and down. Now, I didn't do it. You didn't do it. We didn't do it. But I know a God that can do it. Can you say amen? He run around that church, amen. He was shouting happy. I didn't do it. You didn't do it. They didn't do it. But God can do it. Can you say amen? But somebody, you need to hear me today. Some people would have had that fall on their foot, and they would have cursed God. Hey, with a God, we're in the middle of revival. You're gonna let this happen to me? Why did you do this to me? Other people would have put on frames and like, well, we're having a healing meeting, but I'm sick. I can't go. But Brother Franklin, he got hurt, and he said, wait a second. Look what the Lord can do for me. I'm going to go to the church. I'm going to see what God will do. I'm going to bring, though God's slay me, yet I'll trust him. I'm going to praise him. Now you got to have the right set of frames in your life. Can you say amen? Here's another photo. Throw this other photo up, sister. Amen. Sister Baker. Amen. I asked her if she was Sister Barker. I asked her if she was related to Bob Barker. She's not. I was preaching in Monroe Falls, Ohio for the Mount Summit Pentecostal Church. And I was preaching a service, and I preached and I preached, and when I made the altar call, amen, she came forward. Her husband pushed her in the wheelchair. That's her husband on the right. I'm obviously the guy on the other side. This is mini me. That's big me. Praise God. And long story short, I made the altar call, and everybody repented, amen, and then I went down. And as we began to worship God, I spoke something in her ear, and she melted like butter out of that wheelchair. Just whoosh, slid. I was afraid she was going to hit her head on the foot pedals at the bottom. Caught her by the arm, laid her down. Somebody put a coat over, and everybody else was worshiping God. People got the Holy Ghost. People got renewed. People got restored. Let me explain to you what happened. It is then, near the end of the altar service, I went to her, and I said, listen, are you ready? She said, yeah, you know, and I went somewhere else for just another minute to minister, and I looked back, and she hadn't waited for me. She was already standing on her own. Now, that church is only 5 years old. She's not been able to walk the whole time they've known her. She wasn't born lame, but she's been unable to walk for some time. I didn't do it. You didn't do it. We can't do it, but God is able. Can you say amen? But God is able. I mean, if you just get that one thing today, it could change your life. God is able. Can you say amen? And so here's what happened is, she told me, and at the end, she's pushing the wheelchair out, and I gave her some good advice. I said, listen, ma'am, God has healed you, but your leg muscles are weak because you ain't been walking for years. Amen. She'd gotten an accident. They said she'd never walk again. She had other illnesses. Here she is, long story short. And she began to tell me, so I encouraged her. Amen. I said, build up your leg muscles. So we're talking. I said, she said, I want to share with you. This was on a Sunday. Last night, God gave me a dream. And in that dream, I saw a man preaching, but I couldn't see his face super clear, but pretty clear. And she said, I saw him preaching, and he made an altar call, and I came to the front, and then he spoke some words into my ear. And when I come today to the church, it was a face of you, amen. And you preached that sermon, and when you made the altar call, I came down to the front, and when you walked and whispered the word of the Lord in my ear, you told me word for word what God said he was going to do for me, amen. And I knew the Lord is going to heal me. Oh, somebody ought to shout hallelujah. What are you trying to talk to me about, preacher? I'm trying to talk to you about this. You need to put the right set of frames on your life. God can heal your cancer. Can you say amen? God can heal you, but you praise him whether he does it or not. You give him glory whether he does it or not. I'm going to praise him. I'm going to worship him. I may not know the when, the how, but I know God is able. Can you say amen? I'm going to praise him. I'm going to praise him so much. I've got all the attention of it. Hey, somebody, you in a bad situation. What should I do? You need to take the frames off of your eyes, and you need to start seeing the possibility of God, and God could change your circumstance. Somebody give the Lord a big hand clap of praise. Now, just a few moments more, we're going to open this up. People are going to get renewed, healed, and people can receive the Holy Ghost. This is Sister Evelyn. I was in Boston. I think it was a week or 2 weeks. I tell you, it was the first week of June. Amen. Not long after I was last here. And I had told Pastor Courtney Bennett Sr., because Pastor Courtney Bennett Jr. is his assistant. I said, listen, Sunday night, I want to do a healing and miracle meeting. I asked him how big his church was, because if you've got 1,000 people, I can't have a healing line. I just pray the prayer of faith. You know, I've only got 2 sets of hands. Amen. And so, Pastor Breeze, amen, we did an old-fashioned healing line, amen, on Sunday night. And we prayed for people. Sister, and then afterwards, I asked him, I said, now listen, I tell everybody this. If you lie, you fry. Is that pretty plain? If you lie, you fry. You don't need to build my faith, you understand? Just be honest. But Brother Norman, I was in Vietnam praying for a lady in Saigon. They call it Ho Chi Minh City now. That was last July. Last week of last June, not this year, 2015. Amen. I prayed for a lady that was deaf, and the translator asked her how she felt, and she said she's completely deaf. She said, well, you're a little bit. Amen. She hadn't been deaf all her life. She's honest. I said, okay, we'll pray again. Amen. I prayed for her that time, Pastor O'Donnell. God 100% restored her hearing. I said, can you hear? And the translator started to tell me. I said, you don't need to tell me, man. She's smiling from one ear to the other ear. I done know the answer. Amen. He said, yes, she can hear 100% now. Amen. God has completely... Amen. She'd had one deaf ear and one good ear. God opened it a little bit. She said, no, he didn't heal it all the way. So we prayed again, and God healed it all the way. Can you say, you're not going to hurt my faith. I don't do it anyhow. Only God does. But here's this lady, Sister Evelyn. And so we'd had, I don't remember the exact numbers, well over 10. I don't think it was quite 20, around 15 people that said they were healed after I said, you lie and you fry. I said, anybody want to testify? And Sister Evelyn, she is from Africa. She's from Nigeria. She hadn't been long in Boston. Amen. Got a great job. God's blessed her. Amen. She literally, and I won't go through the details, but she literally said, I want to testify. I have physical tumors on my body, and I have already felt, and they have disappeared. Amen. They have disappeared. Amen. Physical tumors, amen, in parts of her body. She began to feel around. She said, they have all, I didn't do it, you didn't do it, we didn't do it. Now, folks, you can come to the church and say, my Lord, amen, ain't nothing going to happen for me, and amen, the preacher,
don't like me, and nobody loves me, and amen, my Lord, oh, woe is me, amen, all I got, go home, amen, my three P's, amen, and I got to eat stale bread, and nobody wants nothing to do with me. Or you can say, my Lord, I'm blessed. I got food. I get to go to the church, amen. I get to worship God. I get to praise the Lord. My pastor loves me, amen. You can say, well, this is just going to be another altar service. I better stand up there. Or you can say, I wish that preacher would shut up, because God's going to do a miracle for me. I know God's got a miracle. I know when I get down to that altar and lift up my hands, the Holy Ghost is going to fill me, and I'm going to be delivered. I know that when I feel something's going. Hey, preacher, would you hurry up? I got a blessing coming my way.
Same service. Same service. Same song. Same keyboard guy trying to make me look good. Amen. Same sound media. Same preacher. Same God. Different frames. Different frames. Now listen to this, and we'll end with this. If I had quoted John 8 and 58 when Jesus said, before Abraham was, I am. By the way, the Jews knew he was claiming to be God, because if you read on, they took up stones and they tried to kill him, because thou, being a man, makest thyself to be God. Read your Bible. It's wonderful what happens when you read your Bible. And we read that and we say, before Abraham was, I am. Brother, here's Jesus. Jesus was the man, Christ Jesus. See, a lot of people deny the humanity of Christ because they don't read the Bible. He was fully man. One third of God, and are all of God. Either one. They did not die. They did not die. That did not die on Calvary. Can you say amen? The man, Christ Jesus, died on Calvary. Can you say praise God? You say, how do you know he's a man? Well, open the book of Matthew. That's a listing of his human lineage. But he's also Emmanuel, God with us. So they looked at him, and here he is. You're about 32 years of age. What do you mean, before Abraham was, I am? What do you mean? He said, listen, before Abraham was, I am. As God, he had always been. If I'd have told that passage, I could have preached on how God is one, and you'd have shouted and you'd rejoice. Ain't no God but Jesus. Come on, somebody. God and God. That's why we pray in his name. We worship in his name. We marry in his name. We baptize in his name. We live in his name. Whatsoever you do in word or deed, do it all in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Colossians 3:17. But notice that verse 56. Pastor Tana, I've never heard anybody teach on this. Never had anybody address it in Bible college. Can't find it in books. But God spoke to me about it. He said this. He said, Abraham rejoiced to see my day. And he was glad. Wow. Now wait a second, Jesus. Maybe my translation's wrong. Because if you said that you saw Abraham's day and you were glad, I get it. Leave that text up. I get it. You know why? Put the text back up. I get it. Because you're God. You've always been. Before Abraham, during Abraham, after Abraham. But Abraham was just a man. How? And Abraham, yeah, he knew God, but he never saw God manifested in the flesh. He never saw Emmanuel. He never saw the person of Jesus Christ. He never saw, to wit, God was in Christ, reckons. He never was there when he walked on the shores of Galilee and walked around Jerusalem healing all that were lame and sick and oppressed of the devil. He never saw that. How can you say that? And then God illuminated to me that when God called Abraham and he made him a promise that through thee shall all the families of the earth be blessed. That, you know what? Abraham threw some frames off, and he immediately began to see how the day was going to come that God was going to walk among men. Amen. And that's why Abraham rejoiced to see my day. And he saw it. And his vision was so real. It was like he was walking in it and talking in it. And somebody, amen. I said, somebody, you need to hear me today. You need to let God give you some new frames. And you need to see, wait a second. I'm living. Hey, come on, you're going to help me out again. Get up here quick. You go. going to help me out? Won't it? Come on, help me out, one of you. Amen. Help them out. Hold that coat open real big. Amen. You got to see, hey, I ain't got no coat. Amen. But God's got a coat of praise and a coat of glory and a coat of forgiveness and a coat of new beginnings and a coat of joy. Amen. And you don't need to just talk about it and think about it. You need to see it so much it feels like you're putting it on. It feels like you're putting it on. Oh, somebody ought to say amen. That's my coat. That's my coat. Amen. That's my blessing. I'm going to walk in it. I'm going to talk in it. Somebody, you need to hear me today. Put down your mully grubs and see the possibility of God.
Stand with me this morning. Amen. Frames. It'll change your life. Heads are bowed, eyes are closed. Nobody looking but me. Heads are bowed, eyes are closed, please. Nobody looking but me. Amen. Every head bowed, every eye closed, please. Nobody looking but me, the pastor, if he desires. A simple request. Amen. Frames. Frames. Same sermon, same service, same God, and same opportunity. Destroy those frames that say you can't receive. Amen. Destroy those frames that say you're going to come, leave the same way you came. Destroy them. Destroy them. Heads are bowed, eyes are closed. In the name of the Lord Jesus. If you're here today, whether you've been here many services for many years or this is your first ever service here, if you're here and you say, Brother Norman, I need God to forgive me. Something I've said, something I've done, something I've thought. Romans 3:23 said, for all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. By the way, it was written to church people. If you're here and you need the Lord to forgive you of something you've said or done or thought, would you lift your hand right now quickly, quickly, quickly. Be honest before God, please. Be honest. Be honest. Heads are bowed, eyes are closed. Jesus said, if you don't forgive others of the trespasses, your heavenly Father cannot forgive you of yours. Let's be honest. Amen. If you're here today and you've got a hard feeling towards someone, a grudge, a bitterness, a hard feeling, would you lift your hand right now? Come on, nobody's looking but me. Hands are coming up all over the house. I greatly appreciate your honesty. You may lower them. Heads are bowed, eyes are closed. If you're here today and you have never received the baptism of the Holy Spirit with the Bible sign of speaking in other tongues. Acts 2:4. Acts 1:5, Jesus said, John verily baptized with water, but not many days since ye shall be baptized with the Holy Ghost. Acts 2:4, and they were all filled with the Holy Ghost and began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit gave them the utterance. If you're here, you have never received the baptism of the Holy Spirit or the baptism of the Holy Ghost with the Bible sign of speaking in other tongues. Would you lift your hand right now quickly, 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 quickly. Be honest before God. Several hands are coming up. Thank you. Thank you for your honesty. Amen. If you're here today and you say, Brother Norman, I've had that experience before, but it's been a long time and I need a fresh renewing. Would you lift your hand right now quickly, quickly. Hands continue to come up. Heads are bowed. Eyes are closed. You're here and you say, Brother Norman, I need some miracles, Father. I need some miracles, God, from God. Would you lift your hand right now, quickly, quickly, quickly. The altar ministers, salvation captains, amen, would you quickly line up at the edge of the pulpit? I need about 10 of you, real quick, real quick. Amen, I need some altar ministers, quickly, quickly, quickly. If you take 30 seconds, you took too long. I need you up here right now, quickly. Quickly, quickly. Heads are bowed. Eyes are closed. Quickly come. Just put your back to me. Spread on out. Come on. Quickly spread on out. And spread. That means the whole altar. Cover the altar. Left to right. Spread on out. Keep going left. Keep going left. Keep going left. That's left. Amen. Keep going left. Amen. Praise God. Would you look at me right now, folks, in the name of the Lord? Amen. Thank you. Thank you so much. Here's what I want you to do right now. If you raised your hand quickly, I'm not in the begging business, I'm in the blessing business. If you raised your hand that you had not yet received the baptism of the Holy Spirit, I want you to quickly step out from where we're going to all come to the front eventually. I want you to quickly step out from where you're standing, and I want you to come and stand in front of one of these people right now. Quickly, quickly. Don't make me beg you. If you've never received the baptism of the Holy Spirit with the Bible sign, then just go on down a little further. Amen. I want you to stand in front. Quickly, come, come, come. Come, come. Thank you, sir. My good friend I met before service, a nice man. Right here is a good gentleman, one of those two. Just either one of them, you choose. We're all good. Neither male nor female in this church, in Christ. You know what I mean? Amen. Praise God. Anybody else, if you raised your hand, you had not yet received the baptism of the Holy Spirit, come forward and stand in front of one of the ministers. Now, if you're one of those, amen, that raised your hand, that you wanted a fresh renewing of the Holy Ghost, would you come and would you stand right now? Quickly, quickly, quickly. Come on. Stand right in front of this gentleman. Look him in the eye. Amen. You have to help him. He can't hear me. Amen. Yeah. Brother Angel, you're going to have to move. He got first come, first serve. Amen. Okay. Amen. Here you go. I need some. Hey, Mama, Sister Otano, come help me out. Somebody help me. Right there. So, okay, sweetie. Yeah. Somebody, you just stay right there. We'll get some more. I need another helper too. Quickly, quickly, quickly. Here you go. Amen. You'll get you somebody, sweetie. Amen. Amen. She'll help you. She'll help you. Amen. Now, if you all would at the altar, and I know I've slowed it down, I'm telling you the power of God's going to fall. Altar ministers, please wait on me, okay? We're going to do it all together. So wait on me. If you would, just step up close to the one that's in front of you, like 1 foot away. They all took breath mints. If they didn't, and then altar ministers, you step back towards the pulpit. We're going to need the whole altar this morning. Let them step back towards the platform. Let them step towards you, okay? Just step up close. Amen. Now, here's what we're going to do. Many of you raised your hand that you wanted the renewing or you needed the miracle. Right now, as a sign of your faith, I want you to come to the front. We're going to all come to the front before it's done, okay? Please come quickly, quickly, quickly. Hey, listen, folks, it's further from the parking lot to your pew than it is from the pew to the altar. So quickly, and please don't block the aisles so people can come. We've got big areas right here. Amen. Come, 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 come. And altar workers, wait on me, please, okay? Come, come. How are you today? Good to see you. Amen. Come, come. Come, come, come. Quickly, quickly. Yeah, give him room. Come on up, man. We'll pray for you. We'll pray for you, okay? Amen. Come, come, come. And now I'm going to invite everybody else. If you haven't come already, please come. If you all would step on up. Really, I took breath mints this morning. I'm telling you, I'm okay. I'm okay. Come, come, come. We need to make room. The whole church is going to come. The whole church is going to come. And altar workers, just wait a little bit on me. I know you're eager. Amen. But just wait on me. We're going to do it together. Come, come, come. That's all right. Just tell him to get out of your way, ma'am. Come on. There you go. Amen. There you go. Wonderful. Amen. Amen. Somebody say praise the Lord. Amen. Now, everybody, if you would, look at me right now. Right here. We're going to do it all together. There's going to come a moment when these altar ministers are going to lay hands on the people in front of them and pray for you, because the Bible said they shall lay hands on the sick, teaches the doctrine of laying on hands. They'll do it in a godly way, but not quite yet. Here's what we're going to do. We're going to get our hearts ready to receive from God. How many of you know what I'm talking about? What I'm going to do is I'm going to make a call to repent. Now, let me tell you up front, if you have too much pride to repent, it means you need to. You say, but brother, where's Brother Breeze at? I'm going to pick on him. He may have had to leave because of his service. Amen. Brother Breeze is a pastor. Brother Breeze is going to repent with us. Amen. Pastor Otano is going to repent. Amen. I'm going to repent. Hello. You say, but brother, I've been in the church so long, I came with the building. Good. You get to repent too. Amen. And here's what it means to repent. To repent is to sincerely ask Jesus. You don't ask me. No, no. We have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ, the righteous one. You ask Jesus to forgive your sins sincerely. It's as simple as saying and meaning, because the Lord knows your heart. Now, if you ask the Lord to forgive you for lying, but you're already planning on your next one, that's not sincere. Hello. You ask the Lord to forgive you for 2 bank robberies, but you've already got the map, and you're leaving service to go rob another bank, He's not going to hear that prayer. Can you say amen? That's not sincere. I've seen coke addicts leave the altar and go to the toilets and flush their coke. Thousands of dollars down the drain and come back and get the Holy Ghost. I got a preacher buddy that happened to him. Amen. So to repent is to sincerely ask the Lord to forgive you of your sins. Now, I can't say it for you. Sir, ma'am, I can't mean it for you. You, the Bible said in the gospel, Jesus said, out of the abundance of the heart, your mouth speaks. You have to pray. These altar workers, guess what? She's going to repent. And if you have too much pride to repent, again, it just means you really need to. After we take a few moments to repent, I'll give a couple minutes, okay? By the way, it takes longer to go through McDonald's and get you Big Mac than what I'm doing right here. So give me your attention. Amen. After everybody repents, then you know what we'll do? There'll be a point where I'm going to stop, and what I'm going to do is I'm going to pray a prayer of faith, and I'm going to ask God to pour out a great anointing on this altar to heal, to fill with the Holy Ghost, to deliver, to give victory. And then after that, now you don't beg God. Do not beg God. Now I know I'm slowing it down. This, as our Texas friends say, this is not my first rodeo. Amen. Smile a little bit. I'm almost funny, ain't I? Almost. Amen. But I'm slowing it down because I want you to understand what's going to happen. We're going to all ask God to forgive us. You for you, out of the abundance of the heart, your mouth speaking. And then I'm going to pray a prayer of faith. And then we're going to lift our hands, because the Bible says, lift up your hands, all you people. And we're going to begin to worship God out loud. We're going to begin to praise Him. Now, praise is not begging. Do not beg God for the Holy Ghost. Hello. But begin to thank God for His goodness. Begin to brag on Him for how great He is. And as you begin to brag on the Lord out loud with a repentant heart, His Spirit will move on you. The Spirit's going to move on you. And when the Spirit begins to move on you, the next thing you know, these words begin to flow. Amen. And as these words begin to flow in the name of the Lord, what will happen is this, is you just let those words flow. That's just the Bible sign of receiving the Holy Ghost. Can you say amen? Now, how many of you are ready to receive something from God? Are you ready? And I'm going to tell you one other thing. I know how to get red-faced and shout and do all that. We do that. But, ma'am, look at me. You're going to get the Holy Ghost dose today. I'm talking to you, Miss Purple-shirted lady. Look at me. You're going to get the Holy Ghost dose. And I promise you by the authority of the Word of God. Now, I know it's an iPad, but I got three Bibles in it. That's just three Bible apps. I've got about 50 Bible versions in it. Amen. I love my King James version, though. Amen. I promise you by the authority of the Word of God, I promise you that if you'll sincerely repent of your sins, and then when I call to praise God, open your mouth and not beg, but praise God out loud, you know what will happen? The Holy Ghost will fall on you. I guarantee you by the authority of the Word of God. I guarantee it. Look at me. I'm not screaming and dodging. I'll look you right now. It'll happen. Guaranteed. 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 Amen. You see that little Puerto Rican lady sitting right beside you? She's right behind you. You better watch it. She's going to lay hands on you and pray for you. Amen. Now, would you close your eyes with me? Close your eyes all over the house. Nobody looking but the Lord and your pastor and me. And I'm calling on everybody right now. Let's open our mouths and let's begin to repent and ask God for forgiveness.
Father, forgive me. Lord, everything I've said or done or thought against you, God, I'm asking, forgive me. You knowest all things, O Lord. You know my sins and my transgressions and my iniquities, my great faults and failures. But Lord, I bring them to you, my Father. Jesus, I trust you with them. And I ask you, forgive me. Wash away my sins, O God. Create in me a clean heart. Renew in me a right spirit. It's as simple as saying, but meaning, Lord Jesus, please forgive me of my sins. Forgive me, O God. Come on, somebody, repent, for the kingdom of God is at hand. Repent, for the kingdom of God is at hand. Come on, that's it. Just another moment. Ask, sincerely ask Jesus for His forgiveness. Shada la soko moda mahata mahashakata.
Now, if you haven't already, quickly ask the Lord to forgive you. Lord Jesus, please forgive me of my sins. It's as simple as saying that and meaning it. Amen. Now, would you lift up your hands? I'm going to pray the prayer of faith, and then we're going to praise God out loud. Heavenly Father, I come to you by the authority of the Word of God. I come to you by the authority of the promise of God. You said you'd pour out your Spirit on all flesh. You said if you ask anything in my name, I will do it. In John 14 and 14. You said, for with God nothing shall be impossible unto you. You said that I will therefore that men everywhere lift up holy hands without wrath and doubting. And that likewise women also should do it. I come to you by the authority of the Word of God. Lift up your hands. I come to you by the authority in the Word of God, and I pray right now everything and anything that would hinder, I ask, Lord, rebuke it in the name of Jesus, and I pray release an anointing of the Holy Ghost. Pour out your Holy Spirit, pour out your victory in healing and miracles in the name of Jesus. Now lift up your hands, open your mouth, and begin to praise God. Altar ministers, begin to lay your hands on heads. Receive ye the Holy Ghost, receive ye your miracle. Receive you the healing power of God. Come on, everybody in the house, lift up your hands and worship God with everything. People are already getting the Holy Ghost. Amen. Don't beg God, just open your mouth and praise Him. Close your eyes. You're making a choice right now. Choose to lift your hands. Choose to worship God. He's a gentleman. He calls you. Lift up your hands and praise ye the Lord.